So this generation must do to restore our pride and achieve progress for the Urhobo Nation and Delta State. I would therefore like to recall some remarkable achievements made by the Urhobo Nation during the Chief Mukuromowo era. When the Urhobo Nation was faced with adverse British colonial policies that balkanized its territory, the Urhobo people spoke with one voice and successfully persuaded the British colonial government to transfer Abraka and Urhobo clans, which were initially assigned to Abo Division. Ijere, which was part of Benin Division in Benin Province, Udu, Uwe, Ope, Agbon, and Ogara, which were part of the Jekri-Soko Division, with headquarters in Warri, back to Urhobo fold. This eventually led to the creation of Urhobo Division that made it possible for the reunion of the people of Eastern Urhobo with their compatriots in Udu, Uwe, Ope, Ijere, Ogara, Urhobo, and Abraka. We should also remember the threats to Urhobo lands in Western Urhobo during colonial times, and indeed, in the post-colonial era. These threats were huge, but because Urhobo stood stronger together, Ope and Ogara lands in Ijere, Sapele, Ogarefe, and Ogareki were not lost. So too were Ogere lands in Warri. But that wasn't all. The Urhobo people also took their destiny into their hands by developing Urhobo land and its people. They didn't just sit down and wait for the colonial government and missionaries to develop its human capital, the human capital needed to develop Urhobo land. They established a scholarship scheme and Urhobo College, a secondary school that later produced the likes of the late Professor David Opako and Omafume Onoke. Under the scholarship scheme, UPU sponsored the education of Urhobo's first two graduates, Messrs. M.G. Ejaife and E.N.E. who later returned from abroad to manage Urhobo College in Efon. I have chosen to highlight this historical achievement to demonstrate what can be achieved when Urhobo speak with one voice. But worthy of note is that Chief Mukuromowo did not achieve all this alone. The leadership of UPU worked together with various clan chiefs and met regularly in what they call Urhobo General Meeting to formulate an agenda for the Urhobo people. These meetings were presented over by Chief Ayomano of Hope Sapele. Geraldine Marieri served as the honorary secretary of these perennial sessions of Urhobo leaders of thought. Even before the emergence of UPU, we had Urhobo organizations such as the Association of Ogbarai Young Men, which was formed by youths in 1925, the Ogbarai Union, which was formed in 1930, and the Urhobo Brotherly Society, which was formed in 1931 in Warri by insurgent Urhobo nationalists and later changed its name to the Urhobo Progress Union. There are many lessons to take from this era of Urhobo development. Suffering under the yoke of colonial oppression government at a time of serious doubt about peaceful change, Urhobo did not resort to violence. Rather, our people relied on each other, believing that through unity, they will overcome their challenges. Our leaders believed then that if they all, men and women, youths and the elderly, chiefs and the ordinary folks, work together, pulling in one direction, they can overcome the challenges of their time, and surely they did. And so it must be with this our generation. In repositioning the Urhobo Nation as a formidable ethnic nationality in Delta State and Nigeria, we must shun violence and embrace peace and dialogue, and above all, unity. Militancy has no place in Urhobo history. I repeat, militancy has no place in Urhobo history. And our youths, who have been misled and indeed been misled into the destruction of oil facilities, should have a rethink and retrace their steps. That is not who we are. We don't need arms to achieve our goal of economic empowerment and development. As Martin Luther King Jr. once said, unity is a great need of the hour. Unity is a necessary condition for moving forward because it's the only way for Urhobo to be great again. All 24 kingdoms of Urhobo nation must come together and put Urhobo first. Where the self-centered interest of each kingdom or individuals always come first, unity and genuine cooperation is impossible. Therefore, Urhobo must end its infighting and unite. Let's not forget that we are all woven together by God in a single beautiful fabric that is the envy of many. Our forebearers, Chief Mukoromowo, T.A. Salubi, just to mention a few, worked very hard to keep us together. Their efforts must not be in vain. We must work together to build bridges for the progress of Urhobo nation and bring changes to Delta State. Unity will not be achieved in one day, and it will be easy, especially now that we have politics that seeks to undermine and divide Urhobo. Politics that reward self-interest over the common interest. Politics of settlement and appeasement. Politics that set one group against the other in a bitter struggle to gain a larger share of our commonwealth. Politics that put our government at the service of the rich and powerful. Politics that thrives on corruption, cronyism, and total disregard to the wishes of the majority of the people. We can achieve unity of purpose if we really put our minds to it. But that requires a common goal, as no nation makes progress without having a collective goal, which at all times forms the center which all other interests, be it social, cultural, political, and economical, can gravitate. This leadership forum is lacking among today's Urhobo leaders. It's very sad that self-interest of leaders and representatives have now been placed over and above the collective interest of the entire Urhobo nation. As a nation, what is our common goal? What is it that we all can collectively pursue as a people, even with our divergent political persuasion, and still get to that same destination? What is it? As a people, we must first define our political and economic goals and then set out the strategies on how to achieve the goals, because no nation makes progress without a common goal. So the big question before us today is, what is our goal as a Urhobo nation? Where do we want to be, and how do we want to, and indeed plan, to get there? Our forebears were able to imprint the Urhobo nation's name in the world map because they had a common goal, irrespective of their different political affiliations. This is where the present generation got it wrong. And if we must get back to reckoning as a nation and not be dwarfed and displaced by smaller ethnic groups, we must define our goal and channel our collective energy and resources to achieve it. One factor that was germane to the success of the Mukoromowo leadership of UPU was the effective central leadership structure at the time. That appears to be lacking today. The emergence of multi-source group organizations, which are in parallel relationship with UPU, has seriously eroded the strength of the central leadership structure of the early UPU. Many groups today claim to be speaking for Urhobo interests, while in fact, they are in competition with one another for selfish reasons. Therefore, I cannot agree less with Professor Sami Boje, who said that the proliferation of these parallel groups and centers of leadership that are competing for space, loyalty, and followership with the UPU is making it difficult for Urhobo to speak with one voice on major challenges facing the Urhobo people. On the political front, strong and effective leadership also appears to be lacking. When we allow our elections to be rigged by corrupt politicians, and we fail to send our very best to represent us, we only can hope for mediocre performance. In reality, this has been the case. As a result of this, there is general public loss of faith in the political leadership. This must stop. Let's restore the faith of our people in politics. And the Urhobo have a huge role to play in this regard. Because very often, it is the eagerness that are used to promote and perpetuate this election rigging. All my political life, I have believed in change to offer a new beginning to our state. But despite my efforts within and without the PDP, change has been elusive. But more than ever before, I am confident, and I remain confident, that Delta State will soon be free. My brothers and sisters, in my less than 1 year in the Senate, indeed, 10 months in the Senate, two bills, the Federal University of Petroleum Resources FUPRE, a FUM bill, and the Sexual Harassment in Educational Institutions Prohibition Bill, sponsored by my humble self, have since passed the Senate, just giving Urhobo a strong voice in national politics and affairs. Also, upon taking office as your senator, I felt the need to rebuild bridges that have crumbled at the national level. And after due consultation with leadership of my party, the Labour Party in our state, and a wide spectrum of Urhobo people, I, Ovie Omo, I decided to pitch tent with the caucus of the APC in the Nigerian Senate. Chief Great of Agege1, our senior brother and my able leader, the People's General, and all of our fellowship in the Labour Party, we mobilized all of them to join the APC. Today, we have a major political platform on which we can reverse the decline of Urhobo Nation and free Delta State. In the Senate, I support President Muhammadu Buhari, who is committed to transforming Nigeria. Do not be deceived by PDP. PDP cannot bear so. A party that marginalized the Urhobo Nation for so long that they were in power. Not only did PDP marginalize the Urhobo Nation for 16 years, but also did nothing to put Nigeria on the trajectory of sustained growth and development. And because they looted our treasury, they failed to invest in our infrastructure and create a business-friendly environment, thereby making it impossible to diversify the economy. The PDP pursued economic policies that ruin the economy by promoting consumption of foreign goods and not local production. And because we consume foreign goods, our jobs were exported. And that is why we have huge unemployment, especially among the teeming youths of this country. They offered cosmetic changes and delivered no real change. That is why the osse culture is the norm of the day. But today, we have a president we can trust for real change, who is determined to transform Nigeria from a consuming nation. Hear me out. Who is determined to transform Nigeria from a consuming nation to a producing nation, capable of creating opportunities for our people. We must also remember, before Buhari became president, remember how we were ravaged by Boko Haram. Then because he has degraded Boko Haram, some cheap-up girls are now free, and we're now home safer. Our economy has been stabilized, and the long road to recovery has begun. Trust me, the long road to our recovery has begun. The war against corruption is on, and huge sums are being recovered. No matter how bad things are, let us at the very least thank Mr. President, who has deemed it fit to appoint some of our Urhobo sons. Today we have Engineer Ajobe and Chief Francis Ifeduma as both Executive Director of NDDC and Ambassadorial nominees respectively. They come from the Urhobo Nation, and our march towards freedom has begun. Let me also say this. the federal government and the China Civil Engineering Construction Company, CCECC, have signed a memorandum of understanding for the execution of the $11.12 billion Lagos to Calabar Railway project that will pass through several towns in Urhobo land. That project, ladies and gentlemen, is fully funded. That project, Lagos to Calabar, is fully funded. Our counterpart funding has been provided, and the balance for the completion has been provided to us by this MOU that was signed between the Buhari government and the Chinese people. And I say this with pride, because when this Lagos-Calabar rail gets off and running, we the Urhobos are going to benefit a lot. Three major communities in Urhobo land, Ugeni, we have a train station. Uvie, Wari, we have a train station. Sapele, we have a train station. For those of you who know the import and the importance of economic boom, what that means is that the economy of these three communities, these three major Urhobo centers, the economy will pick up. I therefore urge my Urhobo compatriots to join hands with Mr. President in the task of transforming Nigeria and create a future worthy of the visions and dreams of our founding fathers. My brothers, in conclusion, I would like to say that no matter the challenge facing the Urhobo nation today, Urhobo will not be able to overcome its obstacles if we continue to work across purposes. I truly believe that if Urhobo nation is to ever reclaim its pride of place, Urhobo leaders and politicians must start working together towards the collective good of Urhobo nation. It is short-sighted to believe that we could be better off by acting individually. By acting together, we will have credibility in other ethnic nationalities and the real influence to effect change for the benefit of our people. And because a united Urhobo is our only chance to regain our relevance and pride of place in our state and our country, the need for Urhobo unity is dire and urgent. This is exactly why Urhobo patriots should stand together now and give the urgently needed fresh political impetus for unity and solidarity of the Urhobo people under the umbrella of a national political party that will not put Urhobo down. If we can just choose unity of purpose over discord, put aside personal interests and proclaim an end to the accumulated petty grievances and false promises, the recriminations that far for too long have put Urhobo down, and move forward proactively in partnership with President Muhammadu Buhari, we can make the Urhobo nation great again. Before I stop, I am glad I am standing behind the eagerness of Urhobo. I want to make a personal appeal. This is an appeal I have made for some time now, but the appeal is not being heeded. But there is no better place to make this appeal. Please, step forward and appeal to our young ones. This blowing and destruction of pipelines does not help us. We want development. I understand the resentment of our younger ones. If I say I don't, I'll be kidding. But at the end of the day, they must understand that this federal government infrastructures, they are our assets. If they keep destroying these assets, there is no way we are going to have development in this area. Yes, I understand the anger that people from other neighborhoods, other communities, were coming to Urhobo to provide pipeline surveillance contracts. I agree with them. That shouldn't be the case. Urhobos and Urhobo communities should be able to protect and defend their own communities. Pipeline surveillance contract in Urhobo land, I will never support it. Urhobos can do that for themselves. And for as long as I'm your senator, it's a fight I've already started, you can count on me to ensure that during my tenure in the Senate, that 4 years, only Urhobo people will provide those services in Urhobo land. part that I normally say that gets them angry. My office at the Senate is Urhobo office. It is not a Labour Party office. It is not an APC office. It is not a PDP office. It is the Urhobo office. Tell them whatever grievances you have, bring it and we will address it as Urhobo people. So now the gentleman is sharing about it.
Thank you very much. All right, ladies and gentlemen, why the senator?